I'm now very happy to welcome Dr. Yue Leng and Dr. Yaohua Chen. Both Yue and Yao are Atlantic Fellows for Equity in Brain Health from two different cohorts. Yue is an epidemiologist and an assistant professor of psychiatry at the University of California, San Francisco, UCSF. Her research is focused on the relationship between sleep and brain aging, including Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. Yaohua is a neurogeriatrician, a senior physician, and associate professor at the University of Lille, I'm probably mispronouncing that, France. In her work and research, Yaohua values taking into account diversity, gender differences, and advocating for person-tailored prevention solutions. We will hear about Drink It Up, a sip of the Chinese liquor culture. Welcome, Yue and Yaohua. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Camelia. I will just share my slide now. There we go. So before we start, I think we're just going to open this with a poll question, which means the equivalent of cheers in Chinese. I wish you good health. I wish you good fortune. I wish you good appetite. I expect you to finish your glass, or I expect you to not drink too fast.
So, okay, we'll give 3 more seconds for voting.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to show the results. Can you see the results? Yeah.
Yes. So we actually have a quite good range of answers. So this is not so obvious, I guess. So the right answer is I expect you to finish your glass. And so here we go. And that gets us to, so this is our title page, which is Drink It Up, and I would like to take you to a sip of the Chinese liquor culture. And just forgot to mention here, Ganbei is where how we say cheers in Chinese on the right. Right top. So today I will first talk about different types of Chinese liquor and also mention the health benefits and risks. And then Yaohua will share with you some history and hosting culture, and also finally some cultural differences in the liquor culture. So talking about the different types of Chinese liquor is actually pretty simple. So the most straightforward categorization is by the color. And we have huangjiu and baijiu. So huangjiu is the yellow rice wine, which is a fermented alcoholic beverage brewed directly from grains such as rice, glutinous rice, or millet, and usually with qu as starter culture. The alcohol content is usually between 8% and 20%. And we also have baijiu, which is a colorless liquor, and it's clear, distilled, and usually with a higher alcohol content. It's usually sorghum based, but some varieties are distilled from huangjiu or other rice-based drinks. And the alcohol content is between 35% and 60%. And you can see clearly on the pictures, there are different colors of this alcohol. Oops. And when we talk about huangjiu, I think it's really worth mentioning Shaoxing huangjiu. Huangjiu is most common in the Jiangnan area, which is the southeast of the country. And it goes really well with crabs. That's why I'm showing this picture with the crab and huangjiu, and people usually consume this either warm or cold during the fall. And so Shaoxing is actually a city in the east of China's Zhejiang province. And because the brewing technique of Shaoxing huangjiu has been listed as a National Intangible Cultural Heritage in 2006, which means that Shaoxing huangjiu is not only a traditional alcoholic drink in China, but also a significant part of the national culture. So on the right-hand side, you can see this is a picture of workers stirring the ingredients in the wine jars at a rice wine factory in Shaoxing. So unlike Huangjiu, that's only limited to the southeast part of China, Baijiu is pretty much produced around the country. Here you can, if you look clearly at this page, you can see a map of China at the background. And here is also showing for different provinces, pretty much every province has its own signature alcohol. And here I would like to point out especially Sichuan, Guizhou, and Shandong. Pretty much 90% of Baijiu in China have been produced in these three provinces. And of this, Guizhou in the middle here is the most, has the most famous Baijiu and also the most expensive Baijiu in China, that's called Moutai. So I think it's worth mentioning, Moutai is known as a luxury spirit. It's favored by Chinese politicians and business people looking to impress. It's also a favorite drink of China's founding father, Mao Zedong, who famously served it at state dinners during US President Richard Nixon's visit to China in 1972. And in 1974, the US Secretary of State Henry Kissinger told Deng Xiaoping, China's future paramount leader, "I think if we drink enough Moutai, we can solve anything." So I think this really speaks to you know, the brand of Moutai, and it's really for the elite and a must have at business banquets and the display of wealth and power. What's really interesting also is how expensive it is and also how much it's valued in the market. Believe it or not, it's actually the most expensive on the stock market in China. And in 2020, after COVID, it's now bigger than Disney and Coca-Cola. Market values hit $260 billion. So as an epidemiologist, I can't help thinking about how alcohol affects our health, and should we really be drinking alcohol or not, and how much should we drink? So actually, as many of you know, the results have been really controversial, with some studies showing that you know, you should not be drinking alcohol at all, and some others showing moderate drinking actually helps both with brain health and with physical health. And there was also recently a study that found no causal association between alcohol consumption and Alzheimer's disease. And they suggest that most of the previous findings have been subject to survival bias, which has led to the artifact. And I think more related to a culture, a Chinese culture is, or what we would call the Asian flush syndrome. So basically it means that the Asians, they usually develop flush on their face, neck, shoulders, and in some cases, entire body after consuming alcoholic beverages. And it's because of the accumulation of metabolic byproduct of the catabolic metabolism of alcohol, and it's resulted from an enzyme deficiency called ALDH2 deficiency. And it happens in 30 to 50% of East Asians. So that's pretty common. And it's also been found that ALDH2 deficient drinker has 4 to 8 times the risk of developing esophageal cancer. So I think this is a really important health issue to notice. And related to this, some of us know that China also has really prevalent liver diseases. So many, it has a very big burden for liver disease. Actually, China alone bears over 50% of the global liver cancer burden. And on this page, you can see for those with liver diseases, alcohol use exacerbate their symptoms and lead to further problems. So just to you know, think about this more, if you are Asian and if you have this, if you don't have this enzyme and if you like drinking, that's probably, you need to double think about that. And finally, I think, you know, when we talk about Chinese liquor culture, we just can't overlook the medicated liquor. Chinese people like to use precious medical materials or like herbs to make medical liquor, which can reinforce body fluid and nourish the blood. So I think if you really want to get to know the Chinese liquor culture, you probably need to, you know, taste some of this. So this is a snake wine. So snake wine, anyone. So with that, I will pass on to Yao Hua, who will introduce more.
Thank you, Yue. So actually, there is a whole culture behind liquor in China. And in the second part of this presentation, I will focus on history and arts at first, and then I will briefly talk about social codes, hosting ritual related to alcohol in China. We will not have enough time to discuss about Chinese medicine and cooking, but I will be happy to discuss later in the Q&A session. Next slide, please. Yue, could
you? Yes, sorry.
China, as Mary first mentioned in her fabulous talk, China has a very long history. And starting from Xia Dynasty, 2000 BC, and the liquor history started in the same period, according to some archaeological finding. And they found this kind of glass. It is similar to an alcohol container, which could maybe support the idea that alcohol started very early. And in the popular tale, we would say that alcohol has been invented by Yidi in that period to offer as a gift to the emperor. And the evolution of the writing character that represents alcohol is also interesting. Bonli is going to talk about calligraphy later today, so I will not go too far in that. But you can see at the bottom line of this slide, at the left, there is the old Chinese character which represents alcohol at 1600 BC. And you might recognize the middle sign which represents the container of alcohol, and on both sides, probably the drops of the liquor. And later, so the character progressively changed. And so today, in the middle of this slide, you can see the current writing of the alcohol, which still keep the three drops to represent something liquid of this in this character. Next slide, please.
And just to give a 2-minute warning. Thank you.
Oh my God. So not only the writing character changed over time, but the place that alcohol occupied in Chinese society also changed. At the beginning, liquor was mainly used as a sacred liquid, so to give to the god or to any other ancestors. Later in Sui Dynasty or in Tang Dynasty, in 500 to 600, alcohol was more popular and not reserved only for god or for emperors. And especially in early Tang Dynasty, next slide please, Yue, where China was particularly prosperous and when artistic creativity was highly encouraged, many poets embedded alcohol in their creation. So Li Bai here, was the most popular, most famous one, and he was also known to write most of his poems inspired by alcohol. So here is an example of his poems. I will read in Chinese so you can feel the rhythm of this poem, but you can see the translation at the right side. So, 对酒不觉明，落花饮我衣，醉起不惜月，鸟远人依稀. Next slide, please. And in the actual Chinese society, alcohol is omnipresent. And the major difference I feel with the Western culture is alcohol is rather considered as a tool rather than a treat or leisure activity. As Yue mentioned before, alcohol is used as a tool, as a diplomatic tool, and one should show how much he can drink to make a deal with his partners. And alcohol is indispensable in all important occasions that I listed here. And people usually say there's no banquet without liquor, no ritual without liquor, and no custom without liquor. Next slide, please. I know that we are over time, sorry. There is a whole toasting ritual in China. So the first toast should always be given by the host to the guest or to the oldest person who have to return the toast. And you should never drink without toasting. So I left China when I was very young. And when I went back, my family was so surprised and almost reproached me because I was just drinking beers without toasting with someone else around the table. And when you say, you should also keep your glass lower to show respect to the older person. Next slide, please. And what I want just to say, it is especially true for older people and the middle-aged people in China, but currently the Chinese society is changing very rapidly and liquor is usually seen as a tool. Next, please, Yue. And among younger people now, liquor has a new and more Western role to entertain people and to relax with your friends. Next slide. To conclude our presentation with Yue on this liquor culture in China, we would like to point out the differences between China and the Western cultures, as the compound could be different, as Yue said before, but also the role of the liquor is different. In China, it's mostly a tour, but in Western countries, it's mostly a relaxing, a leisure activity. But there are also similarities. I think liquor is always had this important social component. And in a lot of countries, alcohol intake could be a threat for brain health. And we, as a physician, we are all facing the banalization of drinking issues. As in my place in Lille, we will never ask people if they drink alcohol. You should ask if they drink beer, wine, because they will consider beer not as an alcohol. That's the end. Thank you for your participation. Again, sorry that we are late.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Hue and Yoha. Applause for them, even silent applause. Thank you very much. That was just a wonderful, multifaceted look into the different roles of alcohol. And so cheers to that. It was an experience of the taste buds. I'm now delighted to welcome remarks from Dr. Yuda Taruna and Dr. Fasihah Irfani Fitri-Kedokteran. Yuda is a neurologist and is the dean of the Atma Jaya Neuroscience and Cognitive Center in Indonesia. Fasihah, also a neurologist on faculty at the School of Medicine, Universitas Sumatera, Utara in Indonesia. We will hear a musically focused presentation from both on bamboo, a musical instrument, harmonization across nations. Welcome, Yuda and Fasihah.
Thank you, Carmen, for the introduction. Good morning, very happy to everyone. And good afternoon, everyone. Hope all of you in the good health. My name is Yuda Taruna, and my friend Fasihah Fitri Irfani, we are from Indonesia. Today, we will tell you about the bamboo, a musical instrument harmonization across nation. I think everyone knows bamboo, a special and wonderful plant, because this plant has many benefits. This plant is often associated with a culture and a symbol of integrity, meaning in life, friendship, flexibility, gratitude, and so on. In this slide, I share the picture of bamboo, which is often used to drain water in many villages in Indonesia and, of course, remote parts of Asia. Next slide. Bamboo has many benefits, not only helps to flow the water, but is often used as a foundation for building houses, to make plates, cups, spoons, chair, tables, and all the tools used to support in life. In this picture also, we can see that the bamboo was the main media for writing documents in China before the widespread introduction of paper during the first two centuries AD. And bamboo is directly involved in human life since ancient times. Next slide. So there are about 1,200 species of bamboo. an Asian woody grass that widely distributed in the world, naturally distributed in the tropical and subtropical belt, and found in all continents, of course, except in Antarctica. So how about bamboo in Indonesia? Next slide. I will introduce a little about Indonesia. Indonesia is located 15,000 kilometers, and Indonesia is the country with a thousand of island and forests. One of them is the bamboo forest. And my friend Fasihah will tell you more about bamboo. Please, Fasihah.
Thank you, Dr. Yuda. I will continue the presentation. As we know, in traditional Asian culture, bamboo is a symbol of many things. For example, in Chinese culture, bamboo represents the character of moral integrity and tenacity, among others. It is also part of the four gentlemen's or four pillars of life, along with blossom, orchid, and chrysanthemum. In India, bamboo is a symbol of friendship. In Indonesia, bamboo is also a symbol of many things. For example, there is a Javanese philosophy that literally means learning from bamboo, and it represents courage, gratitude, flexibility, and balance. One of the famous quotes literally means that people should be flexible and brave in life. Next. The indigenous knowledge on how to use bamboo has been known for ages. The bamboos are used from the beginning of human life to cut the umbilical cord and do circumcision with bamboo knife. It was also used as a communication tool known as kentong in the villages to inform important announcement to the villagers. Bamboo was also used to build a raft or rakit in Bahasa as a sea transportation. Because we know Indonesia is an archipelago consisting of thousands of islands that are separated by rivers. And bamboo runcing, or literally means sharpened bamboo, is a traditional weapon used by the Indonesian army in the battle against colonialism. And of course, the most common use of bamboo has been as building materials, such as to build bridges and houses, make cabinet, and even to make coffins. Next. And nowadays, bamboo is still widely used, mainly as building materials, but in a more modern style and design, including house, cottage, bridge, and furnitures. Next. The utilization of bamboo by the local people for handicraft also been developed. As we can see in these pictures, bamboos are made to are used to make baskets, chairs, and other crafts like toothpick, chopstick, paperboard, and many more. But besides that, bamboo is also used to make musical instruments used during cultural events. Next. In this slide, we can see that there are many musical instruments that are made from bamboo. For example, a jinghu or two-string fiddle. Its body is made from a bamboo tube covered at the playing end with snake skin. There's also a bamboo flute. I think flute is one of the oldest musical instrument known, especially in Asia. A harp or a string instrument, and there is also a bamboo pan flute that consists of 10 or more pipes in increasing length bound together. And bamboo rain stick, it is a long hollow tube partially filled with small pins that when the stick is upended, the pins fall to the other side, making a sound reminiscent of rain falling. And ukulele, it is a small guitar-like instrument that generally employs 4 nylon strings. And a xylophone is made of short bamboo tubes of increasing length, and it is played by direct striking using a wooden beaters. And next, I will tell about the most famous traditional musical instrument made from bamboo in Indonesia, which is angklung. Angklung is originally from Sundanese region in Western Java. that it is now widely available and played in other parts of Indonesia. It is made of a varying number of bamboo tubes with different size, and it is tied with rattan rope and attached to a bamboo frame. So when shaken, the angklung can produce 2 to 4 pitches that sound at the octave or sound in harmony. Angklung instrument, as we can see from the picture on the right side, can be hung and organized into rows and played solo, or individual angklung, the picture on the left side, can be distributed among a group in which each player is responsible for sounding a single tone. And angklung has also been recognized by the UNESCO as a World Cultural Heritage. Actually, there are many types of angklung in Indonesia, mainly depending on the site of origin, the size, and the events in which the angklung is played. And angklung is closely related to traditional custom, art, and cultural identity in Indonesia. It is a form of musical performance for agrarian rituals such as planting, harvesting, and honoring the rice goddess or Dewi Sri. Next, how is angklung made? So the production of angklung is still traditionally made by specialized craftsmen, so it is still handmade until now. And there are many steps to make an angklung. The first step is choosing and preparing the bamboo. The bamboo is chosen by its age. It has to be at least 4 years old, but not more than 6 years. It is cut in dry season in a specific certain time, at 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And after being cut at its base at about two to three times width of a hand, it should be stored for about a week so that the bamboo will contain less water. So it has to be dried. And after a week, the bamboo should be separated from its branches and cut into various specific size. And the next step, next slide. The second step is making and preparing parts of the angklung. So angklung consists of 3 parts. The voice tubes, which are the most important part. It is the part that produces tone. And the frame that supports the voice tubes to stand, and the base that attached to the frame. And the third step is tuning the voice tube. First, it is done by shaping the bamboo to become lots of voice tube, and then the resonance tuning process by blowing the lower part of an angklung to the floor and measuring it to the tuner. So an angklung usually produces a single tone. And main voice tuning process that includes increasing the tone by cutting its upper parts and decreasing the tone by shaping both voice slots with shaping knife. And the last step is, of course, finishing and maintenance. So in this part, the craftsman has to make sure that the angklung produce the tone correctly. And next, the education about the production or how to play an angklung is still transmitted orally from generation to generation. But nowadays, there are quite many educational institutions that also teach how to make or how to play angklung. And today, angklung performance is still used in many contexts, including harvest ceremonies, parades, entertainment, and as a national music education tool. And here, we will show you one of the
Thank you so much, Yuda and Fasihah. That was wonderful and so energizing with that music of the Angkor. Thank you so much.
Yeah, sorry. I think there's still one more quote from Yuda and Fifi that they would like to share. Can I share it with everyone?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so hope all of you enjoy the bamboo angklung music and the last of our presentation, we will share about the famous idioms of bamboo. Next slide. Next. Okay. This is the idioms from bamboo. That notice that the stiffest tree is most easily cracked, while the bamboo or willow survives by bending with the wind. So thank you, everyone.
Yep, that's it. Pass it back to you, Camelia.
Okay, thank you so much. Again, that was just wonderful music to hear. Yuda and Fasihah, we really appreciate you being here and that presentation and the music. It's wonderful. We're now going to take a 3-minute break. So everyone, please stretch your legs, grab a quick refreshment, enjoy some background music I think we're going to have playing before we continue. Do please feel free to share any ideas that have been sparked so far for you in the chat. That will really help in the Q&A session. So we'll see you in 3 minutes. Thank you. So, welcome back, everybody. I'm now pleased to invite Dr. Yao Hua Chen back to bring us on a culinary excursion with the next section she has prepared, which is called From Stinking Tofu to the Han Imperial Feast, a call for all of your senses in Asian gustatory arts. Sounds delicious. Welcome back, Yao Hua.
Thank you. I was born in China and I moved to France when I was young, so I might have these different perspectives. I think we have a poll question to start with this talk. Carmen, could you share the, yeah. So according to you, which element inspired the inventor of dumplings in 206 BC? Is that fish? Is that an ear? Is that a head, a hand, or the moon?
Can you see the poll status, Yahua? Or do you need me to monitor?
I cannot see it, but I think we can stop.
Okay, yep. No. Let me share the results.
Oh. Yeah, actually it could be very romantic if it's based on moon shape. You will find the answer later if you follow the presentation.
Awesome. Okay.
After the talk about drinking, I will talk about eating. So you will see my main interest in daily life. But at first, Wan Bunling asked me about what I want to talk during this event. I thought it could be nice to talk about some curious food and custom and also the gustatory culture in Asia. But while I was preparing this talk, I realized it was way too ambitious to try to talk about Asian gustatory art. And that is why, if you don't mind, I would change to the Chinese gustatory art. And even that, I learned a lot new things about my birth country. So let's start with some funny stereotypes you may have or not. The basic food in China is rice. Is it true or is it false? So of course it's not true. We also have so many other things. Here is a photo of brioche made by with flour. Chinese people only eat meat. In a Chinese restaurant in France, I found that usually they just propose the meat on their menu and the vegetables are just decorations. But actually in China, people mostly eat vegetables and sometimes meat is just decorative. They don't do dessert in China. Well, it is not true. It is not true. We have dessert, but for sure dessert is not mandatory. I mean, we will not have a dessert at the end of each meal and it's totally fine if you don't have a dessert. Chinese people eat chicken feet. It is true, and Chinese people love eating chicken feet. Actually, you will find people eating chicken feet everywhere, in the train, in the bus even. Chinese people eat rotten eggs. It is not true. It's the picture of this egg, so you might think it looks like rotten. Actually, it is not. So they put eggs inside clay, ash, salt, and quicklime as well for several weeks to several months, and depending on the methods of the process, and at the end you got this result. The egg will be very soft. I don't know the flavor because I never tried and I don't want to try it, but they are not rotten and you can eat them if you want. Chinese people eat insects a lot. It is not really true. I know with the pandemic, there are also a lot of debates around bats, but we don't eat insects. When you go as a tourist in Beijing, Maybe you will visit these streets and you will eat deep fried scorpions or grasshopper, but we usually never eat these insects in the daily life. And there are strange food in China. It is true, at least for foreign people. So here is the photo of stinky tofu. If you have a chance to go to China, you should try them definitely. They smell very strong and not so good, but actually they tasted very, very nice. So when you mention food in China, people, the first thought they will say will be 民以食为天. Food is the god of the people. It is very, very important in people's life. And I will go through the heterogeneity of food in China, the history, social ritual, and also some medicine aspects. So there are different cuisines according to the location and ethnicity in China. I said it was impossible to give you an overview of Asian food. But even China is actually very difficult. In the Han ethnicity, you know, there are a lot of different ethnicities in China, and Han represented more than 90% of people in China. And in this ethnicity, we mainly count 8 cuisine. I'm from Hangzhou here in blue, and our cuisine will be mostly sour and sweet, or sweet and salty. I put also some pictures of other ethnicities, as in Xinjiang, they will eat this kind of naan, or in Mongol, they will eat the whole roast lamb. And in the culinary arts, actually people attach a great importance to all the senses, especially to colors, smells, and tastes, and not just in the restaurant, even in their daily cooking. And they will put some tapioca flour, so to make this glittering on their plate. It is very important for people that the plate have all the senses. And as I said, in the liquor parts, China has a very long history, and food occupies always very important place in people's life. Almost each plate has their own histories. I put here 4 examples. So first with the dumplings. As I said, actually dumplings in the poll question was reported in the Han dynasty, which is 2000 BC. And it has been invented by Dr. Zhang Zhongjing. And he was very concerned about poor people who have the undulure on their ears when it's cold and wet. So he put herbs inside a dough and steamed them to bind everything together to keep them warm. So to prevent also these undulures. So that is why the dumplings have a shape of ears. So people will know that it's to protect their ears. So not the shape of moon, but the shape of ears. The next story is the zongzi. It is made by sticky rice stuffed with a special fillings inside and wrapped up with special leaves. And people eat zongzi actually to memorize Qu Yuan. Qu Yuan is a famous Chinese poet and politician who lived 2000 years ago, and he was highly esteemed. But the emperor will never listen to his advice. That is why when his country was attacked, he suicided and jumped into the river. And people were so sad, and they threw rice into the river. So to keep his body away from the fish or the crabs. And one day a farmer dreamed that Qu Yuan told him that he also wants some rice, but they have to put first into a leaf so the fish will not eat them first. That is why we started this tradition. And actually this weekend we will eat this kind of a traditional food. I will not go to this story because I think we are out of time. And some, there are also some funny expressions around eating. So when people said eating tofu, I don't know if you can guess what that means. So eating tofu, it means someone who take advantage of another person, even in a sexual way. And if you say someone who is eating vinegar, it means this person is being jealous. if you said that someone is eating boars, it means that this person have a solid job. Or if you are eating dates, you know, the fruits, that means that you are assimilating some knowledge without understanding. And when I say to someone, well, you cannot finish eating and take a doggy bag, it means I will make your life very so difficult that you cannot take it. And we will never, well, of course, now we can say, how are you? But people usually said, have you eaten yet? Which means kind of a hello or how are you? How are you? So as I said, there is a whole ritual around eating, around the meal, and they're almost implicit rules. If you don't get it, it is fine. People will not be mad to you because they know that you're not Chinese. A meal is also important tool, just as the liquor, to negotiate around the meal. We said that we never agree on a contract without a meal. It's also a most important time for the family meetings. We usually eat around a circle table, not a square table like as in Western cultures. And the plates are put in the middle of the table, not one plate per person. You should always prefer using chopsticks, and you should never play with them or talk with them, you know, to do gestures with the chopsticks. And you should never show people with them, and never put, you know, in the middle of your rice bowl, which means that you are doing some ceremony for the dead people. So never do that. And in the meal, you usually provide at least one soup. It is good to have always one soup per meal. And you should never finish the plate in the middle of the table, which means the host did not provide enough food. And you should eat slowly without noses and bring the bowl to your mouth. And well, you should put first, you know, you pick the food in the middle of the table and put first in your bowl, and then you can eat. And you should never mix food in the plate, but just pick the first piece that you see on that plate. It is also possible to pick food for older people.
Just the 1 minute mark.
Yeah, thank you, Camilla. So food is medicine. Medicine is food. In contrast with Western countries, I feel that the role of food and the medicine in traditional Chinese medicine overlap. So for example, corn here will be beneficial for spleen, broccoli for lungs, for liver, sorry, and turnip for lungs. And Chinese people will have their own answer to healthy eating with concepts strongly related to Chinese traditional medicine. I think they're probably the most hardcore supporter of the saying, you are what you eat, even if they don't always take into account their own advice. So food have different natures here. There are four natures: cold, cool, warm, or hot. So for example, beef could be considered as hot, and crabs or green tea will be considered as cold. So the nature of the food, as you see, is not determined by the actual temperature, but rather by what effects they have on a person's body after consumption. So when a person continually eats one type of food, it creates an imbalance on their body and affects their immune system. So it is important to keep your body neutral. This is why we also have five tastes. They are not tastes as we can say in the Western country, but mostly as how this taste participates to keep one person's body neutral. So for example, the spicy food will help you to stimulate your appetite. It is also important to know we eat food according to different time during the year. So here I show you the 24 solar terms in the traditional calendar, Chinese calendar. So for example, we just passed the Qingming, the clear and bright solar term. And during that solar term, we can eat this kind of a green brioche. So you eat also according to the season. One thing I think is very important to say here to finish this presentation is to give you a sense of the shift that is currently operating in China with the rapid growth of fast food, deliverable food, and people will cook less at home and have less time to eat and less time to practice exercise. And the shift of way of this living is worrisome, I feel, for young adults and children. The mean body mass index is increasing over time, and the waist circumferences is also increasing with a lot of abdominal obesity. And obesity is a threat for brain health, and also the factors that contribute to it, it also in the modern Chinese society is actually also risk factor to dementia, such as diet change, physical inactivity, or air pollution. So despite of these Chinese specialty specificities in gustatory art and history, when I think about that, I found that we have most similarities between different cultures regarding gastronomy. I think the gustatory culture shape our way of thinking, of living. It is an important social component. It's also part of the identity of our culture. Of course, we have some surprising and unexpected food. As in France, people will point out the cheese, the frogs. The diet change could be a threat for brain health. And I would say, let's eat well to think well. Thank you.
Thank you, Yao. Applause for Yao. Thank you so much. Let's eat well to think well. That's good, a good philosophy right there. There are some great questions about dumplings that we'll be able to address in the chat. Yao, I wish we could reach into our screens to grab some of those dishes from the tasty feast you were showing us. And for our audience, just a reminder, do please keep sharing your comments and any questions or sparks of ideas in the chat for the Q&A section coming up. Don't be shy. It is now my pleasure to welcome Dr. Emmy Kiyota, who is an Atlantic Fellow for Equity in Brain Health as well. Emmy is an environmental gerontologist focused on international and community development. Emmy is the founder and president of Ibasho, an international nonprofit which creates socially integrated communities that value elders. She also consults on the design of communities and cities. Emmy is going to bring us on a tour of Buddhist temples in Asia with her talk, Architecture for Worship. Take it away, Emmy.
Thank you. I have to actually fix the one introduction slide. I'm not MD, by the way. I just saw the MD behind my name. It just like makes me so nervous. I'm not MD. So just wanted to make the correction. Let's see. Yeah. So I would like to share my observations and the learning that I have from my life basically. So I'm not an architectural historian. I am not a Buddhist specialist, but I kind of took this opportunity to teach myself about the kind of things that I didn't actually know about, and I wanted to share some of the really basic information and just kind of see the architecture together and see how things are different. And you know, there's certain similarity behind the themes. So the Buddhism, it is just, again, Mary had much more intellectual explanation about all this. So I'm not going to go through much, but again, there's certain things that it's always nice to revisit. So this was the Buddhism started in India, and it was, we hear a lot about Buddha, but I've learned this time that some people think that Buddha is enlightened human beings, and some people think that it is a specific person who started. And both are right, and I think it depends on what you believe, and that actually creates three types of Buddhism. I this was a little challenging because I've learned all this in Japanese language, and this is very different language. So I'm not sure if I can just pronounce it right. But there are three basic, like a major Buddhism group. And I grew up in the Buddhist family in Japan. Obviously, I belong to the first one, Mahayana Buddhism, which is not as strict as the second one, Theravada Buddhism, which I've actually learned about that when I was in Sri Lanka and Thailand. The way that they worship and they practice Buddhism is much more strict and, you know, it's much more disciplined, to be honest. And the third one, it is much more like a esoteric Buddhism. And it's really based on Himalayan area like Tibet and Bhutan. So I just really wanted to take you down to my own journey. I could not speak about the countries that I didn't visit. So I am actually going to be sharing some of the observation from the point of view where I visited. I luckily was able to visit those countries that covers all these three places. I didn't visit. I was born and raised in Japan. This is one of the oldest temples. It's 3,000 years old, and it's like the oldest wooden structures that we have in Japan. So this was the Buddhist temples, actually. People practice. Basically, it is much more like when you chant and then you are going to be enlightened. I mean, you're going to be saved. And it's much more to do with peace and just a way of life rather than practice. So this was a stupa that I found in Sri Lanka when I was working in the project in Sri Lanka. So the stupa is a place where you keep the Buddhas born, actually. I don't know how much of it it's real because it's like thousands of temples and stupas around in the world. So I don't know how many Buddhas born could be actually distributed, but that one I couldn't really get to the bottom of it. I just tried to Google it, but I couldn't really figure that out. This was the temples that I visited in Thailand. To me, it was quite learning and shocking because it was so shiny and gold, and it's very different from how I was raised in the Buddhist temples. So Thailand, I found that it was very colorful and people really do celebrate Buddhism. And this was another surprising, and it was really fascinating. This was like giant Buddha lying down, and this whole building was designed to store this giant Buddha. And it was just really nicely done. And again, this was very different from how I was raised. And this is another shape of Buddhism. It's in Nepal. It is, everybody knows Kathmandu, but this one is called Patan, which is UNESCO World Heritage, actually. If I have a chance to really go into a detail, I will, if you're interested, I can go into this. Nepal is very interesting because they're very accepting culture. So it started with Hinduism and they move into, you know, they started to accept Buddhism. And then they also integrate other parts of, you know, Tibetan Buddhism. So they're very accepting. So that actually shows in the architecture. So it's a little bit mixture of different things, but it is really a Buddhism-based architecture this way. And this is stupa in Nepal. It's very different from the one in Sri Lanka. It has a little, I always found it a little scary to see this like Buddha's eyes, kind of like see through you, but you just go to a stupa that you see this. So it is quite a large area. It's almost like, the humongous stupa sitting around in the whole neighborhood and people actually do play everyday basis. This I found in Bhutan, actually. Bhutan has, it's much more mythical belief, and it actually shows in architecture. It's on the top of the mountain. I needed to walk for 4 hours to get to this. But again, you know, it's just Tibetan Buddhism, Bhutan Buddhism is actually coming from Tibetan Buddhism. They really do believe mythology almost. So, you know, they like to just keep the temples in the cloud. That's what they their idea coming from. This is another temples from Bhutan, but it is not, this is more like, it's called Thon. It is the place where major kings and monks used to live. So this is how the buildings are different. So I really wanted to kind of share some of that. It's the same Buddhism, but it is a different architecture. And I just also wanted to take you down to Japan because that's where I grew up, but I can actually talk about it a little bit more. So Buddhism in Japan, it is actually a major the religion, but people, it's almost like I'm becoming like a tour guide. When you come to Japan, you will see shrine and temples, and people always ask me what's the difference between temples and shrines. So I'm just going to take this opportunity to tell you. So temples are for the Buddhism. Shrine is for the Shintoism. You know, Japanese people actually do believe two religion at the same time. And it's just not competing. It is just there. And Shintoism, it is more like a tradition than a religion. So the one on the right, you see all this gates, those are not temples, actually, those are shrines for the Shintoism. So this is a Shintoism shrine. So this is one of the most famous one. So they just keep building this shrine. It's important that it's a part of the nature. So it just, so people actually keep building like a new one right next to it. And they just like keep on going, and it just is integrated back into the nature. So they don't use any materials that disintegrated into nature. So this is another one. These are like, this is a Shintoism. It's not like a Buddhism. And this is one of the famous one. It is in the ocean again. But this was rather art, like a later time of the shrine. So people start to use a little bit more color. And this is another one with color white and red. This is very typical Shinto shrine. So I just wanted, I just got some data about how many temples and shrines in Japan. I don't know, I should have done this as a poll, but I was very surprised. There are 77,000 shrines in Japan and 88,000 temples in Japan. So you probably heard about Kyoto. That's the place where very highly concentrated temple area. They have 2,500 temples and shrines in Kyoto. So if you ever just try to travel to Kyoto, just try not to even think about going into every single temple because it's impossible. So in Japan, their Buddhism has like six different schools. So it's Tendai and Shingon and Jodo and Jodo Shinshu and Nichiren. And the last one you probably are most familiar, it's Zen groups. So when people say Zen, it is not like Buddhism really. It is a part of that, one of the group of Buddhism that was developed in Japan. They really exercise by sitting. So they do everything just enlightened by sitting. So how does that architecture manifest it? This is again, revisiting like one of the oldest temples. It's called Horyuji temples. And this is in the Nara area, which is about 700. I think some Chinese colleague will say, oh, these are not really old, but it is for our standard. It's called Yakushiji temples. So this is another one, temples in Kyoto. It just, it has a Shingonshu. So I'm just trying to cover different groups of buildings. And this is another temples, but this is very typical in Japan that it's not much colors unless they have special meaning to red. So this you probably, if you go to Kyoto, this is the place you probably visit every single time. It's called Kiyomizu temples. This is quite famous temples because they don't use any needles, and it's very, very large structure, but they don't use any, you know, nails and anything. They just use woods. And so this one is a giant Buddha actually sitting inside. It's called Todaiji temples. So they have much more bigger technique. You know, when we don't really see it inside, but the technique was developed that we have smaller sort of column system. It used to be a large tree that was kind of holding onto this, but we have technology developed so that it's just, you know, people can have much more space inside. So this is like, again, it's another typical thing you probably see in the pictures. This one, I actually learned it myself, to be very honest. I So it's the, they have a meaning to five tower with like five layers. The bottom one is represent earth, and the second one represent water, and the third one is fire, and the fourth one layer is wind, and the top one is represent sky. So basically these five layers of like that the tower, it's again, it is a place where we supposed to keep Buddha's born, born, you know, just body born, but it really represents the universe. That's what it is.
Just a 2 minute one. Thank you.
Sure, I can do that. So when you see the temples, you actually see the garden actually goes with it. It is a very important part of the architecture because people normally like to create the universe within the space. So you need to have garden that also represent universe. So I wanted to take you from here, like a time transcending. This is a traditional garden that we had. And this is how it is modern interpretation of garden and the universe in modern society in Japan. And I think this, you know, shrine and temples, this is also a temple was designed by Tadao Ando. It is very modern interpretation. And this is another temples, actually. They keep, it's a beautiful place. It keeps Buddha in this way. So it just, you know, things actually evolve over time. And this one I needed to share with you because this is connected to dementia, actually. So this was old temples that people were not using it, but it is very familiar place for the older populations. So they decided to transform this into a day center, and it's run by people with developmental disability community, and they have created the cafe. So this is how it's looked like in Japan, but it used to be a temples. I like to end with a quote. When I was talking to Brunid, we talked about this, you know, Asian and sensitivity and all. And I found this when I was going through like similarity and differences, what unite us. And I found this Maya Angelou's quote. It says, we all should know that diversity makes for a rich tapestry, and we must understand that all the threads of the tapestry are equal in value, no matter what their color. I thought it was a really nice way to connect. It's not only about Asia, but it is really about diversity. And I really hope that you can visit in Japan and look at the five, you know, layer temples and think, I know what that is.
Thank you so much, Emmy. Let's have some applause for Emmy and that wonderful presentation. That was a beautiful look at Buddhist temples and Shinto shrines. And we just appreciate you so much. And thank you for that quote at the end as well. I'm now very happy to invite back Dr. Boonli T to shift us to the power and beauty of calligraphy with art and cultures through penmanship. The floor is yours, Boonli. Thank you.
Thank you, Camelia. Thank you everyone for staying on. Okay, so I'm going to talk about calligraphy. Okay, and so I'll start with looking at the atlas of writing system. So we know that, you know, based on ethnologue, language ethnologue, there's like 7,000 living languages worldwide. And there are also a lot of different writing systems. And in general, we can categorize them into five different categories. Or four different categories, sorry. So there's the alphabetic category, so where the graphic grapheme symbols signify phonemes. So for instance, like the word ke-ata, the word cat is represented by three phonemes, ke-ata. So you can see that each alphabet correlates with one phonemes. And then we have the abugida writing systems, where each grapheme symbols represents a syllable. So like, for instance, ka, ku, ki, and ke, and ko, they are all different symbols, and they are not like two letters. And then in contrast, we have the abjad writing system. And in this writing system, the grapheme symbols stands for the consonant, and they usually especially the traditional version of it, doesn't have the vowels in it. So the readers actually have to infer an appropriate vowel when they see the consonant. Although recently, I think that included the vowel through diacritic. So one example is that if you see the word here, it's actually three consonant DBH, and based on the different grammatical structures in Arabic language, then you add in like different strokes or points on top of it or below it, or that you kind of connect the consonant differently. So the way to connect them is something we call ligature. And this is a bit more flexible. So there's this slight spatial flexibility in writing Arabic language. And then the last is actually, logographic script. And so logographic script originates from pictographic words. So in other words, the word form actually resemble the visual image of the object. And then as the language evolved, all the pictographic units are then combined together to form what we call as compound character. And there are more than 16 kinds of different visual spatial configurations for the compound characters. And then there's also a vast variability in the visual complexity of different characters. So you can see that in some words, there's only one stroke. And then in other words, there's 172 strokes. So I would say in general for both abjad and logographic scripts, they tend to have more spatial flexibility. So there's more variability in their calligraphic art, which is why today we're going to talk about Chinese as well as Islamic calligraphy. And so for Chinese, calligraphy is held in very high regard. And in ancient China, you need to actually master four art techniques in order to become Chinese scholar, and calligraphy is one of them. And so according to Han Dynasty philosopher Yang Xiong, he said that words are actually the voice of the mind, and calligraphy or literature are the portraits of the heart. So there's also another idioms in Chinese culture that's called 自如其人, which means that handwriting represents a person's personality. So, you know, like in ancient China, for a Chinese scholar to succeed, they actually have to have good penmanship. So like, for instance, like this Chinese scholar Wen Zhengming, he spent 30 plus years of his time attending, participating in the imperial exam. And he was very talented, but he was always rejected because of his handwriting. But he was eventually, promoted, and then actually known as one of the four greatest scholar in that era. So, but, because of his penmanship, he did go through a long period of time of not being recognized. And let's look about how Chinese calligraphy started, how the history appeared. So it first appeared as an oracle bone script where Chinese characters are written on animal bone or like turtle plastrons. And shown here is actually the word for horse, which actually resembled the physical form of horse. And then later on, there comes the bone script. Inscriptions of Chinese characters where Chinese characters are engraved over the bone ritual tools. But these two scripts are not no longer being used. What's being used now is one of it is called the seal script, which started in Qin Dynasty. And so you cannot see such of a seal script in a lot of the decorative engravement or seal that sometimes we use now. And then there's also, when you enter into the Han Dynasty, emerged the clerical script or the chancery script. So these scripts are considered more highly legible comparing with the previous script. You can sometimes see in headlines, signboards, and advertisements. It has this more rectilinear structure where it is, square, but it's in contrast with the regular script that we'll see later. This is a bit more wide, and you can see a typical stroke, a horizontal stroke for clerical script has this round silkworm head-like, start, but then ending with a swallow tail flaring out stroke. So in order to produce this stroke, you actually have to turn your brush 3 times to accomplish it. So this is why it's not that popular now, but it's actually my favorite. But it's not that popular because it's not that time efficient. So what is being most commonly used is actually what we call as the standard script or regular script, which I'm showing here now. And it's actually, you know, faster to actually write the stroke out. And then there's also even faster way of doing it. So the more faster, the faster version of a standard script is that semi-cursive script, where they tend to connect some of the character strokes in between. So shown here on the left is actually a standard script, and on the right is a semi-cursive script. So you can see that a lot of the strokes are actually connected with each other, so you don't have to lift up your hand and it saves you some time. And then even a more you know, extreme version of it is the cursive script, which is what in Chinese they call it chao shu, and chao, the word chao is actually like quick, rough, or sloppy. So this is like a form of shorthand script. So you don't usually use it for official purpose because it's also a bit hard to read sometimes. So now I'm going to, there's also 4 things that you need in order to complete calligraphy. So it's the brush, ink, paper, and inkstone. The brush is probably the oldest one, and it's made, the brush in front of it is made of white gold, black rabbit, or yellow weasel hair, but sometimes they use baby hair as well, and it's actually a good omen, like so it means that you'll probably do well in the imperial exam. And then there's the ink. It was previously made of graphite and vermilion. Now it's actually mainly made of soot, and sometimes they add in spice or medicinal herbs so that it has a good fragrance or it's good for your health. And then there's the inkstone, where you grind the ink on it to generate the inkstone, to generate the ink to write. And then you have paper, and we previously talked about that. So let's move on. And then I'd like to introduce you to the 4 great calligrapher in China. So for standard script, and you remember how we said that writing style represents the personality of writers. So take a look at how some of the Chinese scholars describe the different calligraphy styles. So like for instance, Ouyang Xun is described as rigorous and sharp. Yan Zhenqing is described as dignified and majestic. And then there's Liu Gongquan, that's described as structured with strength. And then there's Zhao Mengzhao, which is described as delicate and graceful. And I wanted to introduce you to another famous calligraphy work that's actually done by Kangxi Emperor in the Qing Dynasty. When his grandmother was sick, he actually prayed for 3 years and wrote down this word, blessing, fu. And so if you look at the word structure, it actually hidden in within the word, there's you know, parts of the words that resemble plentiful, children, land, talent, and longevity. So combine them, it means that there's significance, like that it means that there's like abundance of children, abundance of land, abundance of talent, abundance of longevity, plus blessing. So it's actually considered as the number one word of blessing in the world. And so you actually can see it in the Prince Gong Mansion in Beijing. So whenever you visit it, you should go and have a look. And then I wanted to mention seal script in the form of seal as well. Chinese seal is actually a very strong symbol of power and identity. So like the nation actually have seal, even in modern time, it's usually made up of jade. So like one of the things that you do when transitioning during presidential or inauguration ceremony, you have to pass on the nation's seal to the next president. And then it's also like a lot of formal official documents, you have to have a seal chop on it to make it official. And even on a personal level, you have to have an identity seal. So I remember when I started internship, the first thing I had to do is actually craft out my own seal. And I, on prescription, I use seal instead of signature. So it's actually equivalent to signature back in some of the Asian countries. And you also will see that, you know, in some of the artwork in Chinese artwork, there's a lot of seal chop on it. So some of it is actually the author, but a lot of times they are actually people that once owned the art pieces, and then they kind of chop it to share that they, you know, have seen it before.
And just the 2-minute mark. Thank you, Bunlit.
Okay, so I'm going to skip this in the interest of time, but I'm going to move forward with the Islamic calligraphy. So the other, I think, very highly versatile calligraphic art form is the Islamic calligraphy. And like Chinese calligraphy, is actually high, regarded as valued art form as well as signifying moral virtue. So a proverb in Arabic actually states that the purity of writing is the purity of the soul. So traditionally, Islamic calligraphy uses kalam, which is a pen made out of dry reed and bamboo. So unlike Chinese calligraphy, where the brush tip is quite soft, this one is actually a bit hard. So you can see that the wordings are more angular. So the common used style of writing is kalam. Is kufil, and then there's the nashk, and then there's the tuluth. And you can see kufil is the more ancient one. So it's more angular. There's less diacritic, so there's less vowel in it. And then it's more rigid. Whereas nashk and tuluth, there's more curvature, there's more diacritic. And then this one is actually the Saudi Arabia flag. So you can actually see the tuluth Arabic script on the Saudi Arabia flag. The one that I love most about Islamic calligraphy is actually the zoomorphic form of it. So they kind of incorporate really well the Islamic calligraphy with the different animal, flower, or fruit form. And I can, compared with the Chinese character, it's a bit more rectilinear. So you don't have that versatile property or curvature property to allow you to incorporate and blend it so intricately. The last thing I wanted to share is that, artistic depiction of people and animal are relatively not encouraged in Quran. So a lot of the picture has been represented by calligraphy because they don't want to encourage idols in their culture. So one thing that you might notice in a lot of Islamic architecture or Islamic art pieces or coin or porcelain, they don't have that much picture of people, but they have a lot of calligraphy that blends in really well with their geometric shapes and tile works. So with that, I hope you enjoy the brief introduction about Chinese and Islamic calligraphy and appreciate the commonality and the differences of calligraphy in both cultures. So
thank you so much, Mead. And let's have a round of applause for Boonlead. That was wonderful. The different types of calligraphy were absolutely beautiful. Thank you. So just in the interest of time, because we have about 3 minutes, we probably have time for one question and then we will collect the rest of the comments and questions. The one that I saw in the chat related to dumplings, actually. So this might be a question for Yaohua or some others to add in. Mary had commented, I thought that the dumplings were meant to look like ingots of gold. Is this correct? Different stories, and Lisan had agreed with Mary, saying the dumpling is also sometimes called yuan bao, which means gold ingot. So Yao, or if anyone else from the panel wants to comment on that.
Yeah, I agree. We also have the similar shape to look at gold, and we can make some when we go to a funeral or to a people's tomb. But actually the dumpling, jiaozi, really the other shape with the, you have to make, I'm with my daughter now. You have to make this, and this looks really like ears shape, and it was made from that shape. But I agree, there's the other thing. Shh.
And Boonlead, I don't know if you want to share one of the questions that you also had
in the list. Okay. Yeah. I have one that I'm not sure. Well, I wanted to ask, other people's thoughts about culture. Like, do you think it separates us or it unites us? Like, in some ways, I think it's also a form of us othering people, but in other ways, it also brings us together and build a lot of empathy. So I wanted to hear what other people think about it. Should I ask someone? Anyone has some thoughts about it?
I think if we have one brief comment, and then we should probably move on.
Yeah.
My opinion is it depends a little bit on your perspective and how you approach the challenge. We've heard some fantastic stories today about how culture brings people together. And yet it's also, we heard stories of how pieces of culture are different. And sometimes people are more likely to embrace the differences or feel that they're different from that group and lead to othering. So I think what we have to do is have conversations and dialogues like these to get to know other cultures in a strong way, and that will increase empathy and understanding, and will avoid othering and help us to achieve more of a sense of belonging. So I think the work that you've done today, all of you, is really trying to change that narrative that we're not afraid of differences, but we embrace them and we use the cultural differences to belong.
Thank you.
Very beautifully said.
Thank you so much, Victor. Shall we move on to Dr. Miller? Okay, let's do it. So we're at the hour. If you can stay with us just two more minutes, that will be wonderful. It is now our pleasure to welcome Dr. Bruce Miller to join us. Dr. Miller is the co-director of the Global Brain Health Institute and is the director of the UCSF Memory and Aging Center. We welcome him very much. He's also a longtime champion of bringing the arts together with science for innovation, creativity, and community building. Welcome, Dr. Miller.
Thank you. What an honor to participate and learn today from Mary, a leader in one of the most impressive museums I've ever seen, our Asian Art Museum in the city of San Francisco. I think the contribution of Asian cultures to the city began early. It has been profound. I think it is one of the reasons one of the best, most diverse and most inclusive cities in the world. I think the talent that was displayed today was just extraordinary. I had no idea really how much each and every one of you had to offer us about the cultures of Asia, which certainly fascinate all of us. I just can't thank you enough, Boon Lead, and all of the people who participated today in educating us. And I would end with what Victor said. I was thinking very much the same thing. An event like this, which imbues us with the beautiful cultures of Asia, really is inclusive. It includes people who are outside of the culture, and I think can only be the opposite of othering. It brings together. This is really, I think, a model for the rest of the world. So I hope we have many more events like this and more interchange about the arts and the brain. I was just absolutely thrilled. It was just a magnificent morning. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Miller. Thank you for giving us such a nice closing remark. With that, just 1 minute, I wanted to share acknowledgement slides, just to highlight all the people that work on this. And I think first of all, definitely a huge thank to Dr. Mary Mead from Asian Art Museum to grace us with such a good presentation on the Silk Road. I learned so much, but I also wanted to thank all the fellows that came together, as well as Yuda, Emmy, Fifi, Yao Hua, as well as Yue, to make this possible for us to share. I know they are always very busy, but they took time and put this together. And a huge thank to Camellia as well for moderating the whole event, and Carmen for the logistic, and Bruce and Victor for supporting us to do this. I just wanted to thank everyone. And I hope you enjoy this. I hope this is a great morning to start your morning with, and you have everyone have a good day. And we'll follow up with a survey. So if you can please spend a few minutes to complete the survey for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you.